Hello, this is the next beginner's video for functional safety in automotive. This one is about software development for electronic systems for road vehicles, especially for the software used in control units in cars. If you are involved in such software development, you should probably know what is different from software development in other areas. My name is Erwin Petri, I have a PhD in computer science and made this video for you in my role as an expert for functional safety at Kugler Maag. If you watch this video, you will quickly come across the points of software development where you have to adapt your approach to the automotive industry. We're talking here about software in road vehicles. That's all the software in the various control units, sensors and actuators. Functional safety now means that this software contributes to the safety of the vehicles and does not endanger safety. More specifically, the software must be error-free in keeping with its specification. This is what functional safety and the international standard ISO 26262 is about. However, we are not talking about whether the specification itself for that software in the vehicle is sufficiently safe. This is another topic called safety of the intended functionality, or SOTIF. An example of such an inadequate specification is when a vehicle manufacturer sells automatic driving and suggests to the driver that he can read the newspaper while driving, but that software, according to the specification, cannot distinguish a trailer standing on the road from a clear road with a blue sky. Then the software can be correct in terms of functional safety, but not in terms of its actual function. So, when it comes to everything that needs to be considered when developing safety-related software, you have to apply Part 6 of ISO 26262. This graphic shows how software development is embedded in the overview of all parts of ISO 26262. In the next minutes, I want to work out 9 key lessons for you, and I will explain to you where you have to adapt your software development for the automotive sector if you have only written software for other applications. First of all, we have to state that road safety not only depends on compliance with traffic regulations, but that the vehicles themselves pose a risk to human life if they behave incorrectly. For example, if a car accelerates incorrectly without someone actuating the accelerator pedal. The more modern the vehicles become and the more progress is made towards automatic driving, the more software in the vehicles determines their behavior. The safety of the vehicles, be they cars, trucks or motorcycles, is increasingly dependent on error-free software. I would like to formulate a first key lesson from this. With increasing proportions of software in vehicles and with further steps towards automatic driving, the safety of vehicles depends more and more on error-free software. This conclusion justifies that software development for automotive uses must be different from software development for other applications. It's simply unacceptable if software does not respond to a driver's braking request simply because it's busy cleaning up memory. Now, which strategy leads to error-free software? Answering this question brings us to 2 further points that need to be noted. The first is related to the fact that software, unlike electronic components or memory areas, cannot fail randomly. If software doesn't do what it's supposed to do, it's a systematic fault by definition. I will give you a few examples of systematic software faults. Not all of the prescribed tests have been successfully completed, and yet the software has been released. Or the allotted time for an algorithm to detect a dangerous traffic situation was calculated as too long, so that a collision occurring beforehand is inevitable. Or another one, The state transitions of a control unit are incompletely specified so that it's left to chance during programming what the software does. To prevent all of these things happening, software must be developed using an up-to-date and sophisticated process. I would therefore like to formulate the second key lesson as follows. Software faults must be avoided through systematic development. Errors must be prevented. Prevention is good, but prevention is no guarantee that a situation will not occur that wasn't thought about. This leads us to the third key lesson. The occurrence of faults must be countered by mechanisms for fault tolerance. Checksums for messages or memory areas are an example of this. Or simply checks on permissible value ranges when entering a software function. Or something more sophisticated, software that runs on so-called safety microcontrollers and is used to monitor whether the actual application software is still running correctly on another microcontroller. Such software must then bring the entire system and vehicle into a previously defined safe state when errors are detected. All of these principles underlie software development for automotive applications as contained in Part 6. We now go into this Part 6. Within the entire safety lifecycle, which we already know from the previous videos, software development is integrated here in parallel with hardware development as a separate discipline within the system level. For software development, this reference model is defined in ISO 26262. It is a V model, almost identical to that defined in Automotive SPICE. The focus here is now on adaptations specifically for automotive functional safety. In terms of functional safety, software development is based on the technical safety concept with its technical safety requirements for the software shown here top left. The developed software then flows into the integration and tests at system level shown here top right. We are now concentrating on actual software development. I come to the fourth key lesson. It says, functional safety requires the software development process to be adapted to the requirements of ISO 26262. I want to explain this. It's a prerequisite that you develop software according to a suitable documented process that is believed in and applied. This process must be compliant with ISO 26262. You must have a suitable software development environment, which is not different from non-automotive applications. You have to comply with coding and modeling guidelines for which ISO 26262 lists a number of specific criteria. This is typically implemented in the industry by MISRA rules. A current question is whether agile software development and functional safety are compatible. Yes, they are, but only if a number of things are taken into account. ISO 26262 requires you to provide certain documentation, especially in connection with the safety case. This does not prevent you from having daily stand-up meetings and continuous integration, both of which are very useful. As soon as you want to release software that is actually going to be installed in vehicles that drive on the road, you have to proceed with rigorous processes. You can then no longer quickly implement a customer request and deliver software. Correct software behavior depends not only on the software code itself, but also on the data that controls it. This fact requires that you subject configuration and calibration data to the same development process as the software itself. Finally, with the various interfaces that exist today in vehicles to the outside, it's necessary that the cybersecurity dangers are analyzed and addressed according to appropriate standards. All of these are topics that you must have taken into account into your development approach. We're now getting into the V model for software development. Our fifth key lesson is technical safety requirements must be detailed down to quality software safety requirements in order to be implemented in the software. These are self-test and monitoring functions for operating system, basic software, and application software. It concerns requirements for the detection, indication, and control of faults of safety-related hardware. Requirements must be written for when and how a safe state can be achieved and maintained in the event of a fault, or at least define how a degraded state can be achieved. What are the requirements for fault tolerance? How often must test algorithms run and how quickly must error reactions be implemented at runtime? Software development must also contribute to the specification of the interface with the hardware. The next logical phase is software architecture. I would like to formulate a sixth key lesson. The software architecture must implement all functional requirements as well as safety mechanisms. What this points to is the intended functionality and the software safety requirements. In electronic control units, the actual functionality and its safety features are mixed and often cannot be separated. The ISO 26262 requirements largely overlap with automotive SPIs for this phase, which is why I would like to add only one aspect from the point of view of functional safety. You have to carry out so-called safety analysis, in which you understand dependencies between failures. If you want to implement individual parts of the software with different ASILs, you must have good arguments as to why software implemented with weaker criteria, that is, more dangerous software, does not endanger more critical software. This is called freedom from interference. The analysis must consider runtime behavior, memory areas, and message traffic. Ultimately, all the analyses are about securing the software design. I would like to capture this topic as the seventh key lesson. Safety analysis must be performed to understand the dependencies between software components and validate the software design. The next phase is again very similar to any other software development process, for example, in compliance with automotive SPIs. A software unit design is required, which can also be used as a model for applying model-based development. ISO 26262 also has criteria for guidelines that must apply here. There is no key lesson to capture at this point from a functional safety perspective. We now leave the left design side of the V model and look at the right side for integration and testing. From the point of view of functional safety, I see two things that I would like to highlight as major differences from software development in the automotive sector. First, there is my eighth key lesson. Software integration and tests must be specified in terms of methodology and carried out successfully. And my ninth key lesson is test coverage must be measured to understand the completeness of tests and support the rationale for having achieved test goals. This summarizes in two statements what goes beyond normal software development. Okay, on the level of the individual software units, verification includes ensuring safety mechanisms are implemented, that there is no unintended functionality in the code, and that there are sufficient resources, that is, execution time, memory, and throughput of messages. ISO 26262 requires that test cases are developed using a number of methods and that certain kinds of tests are performed. Depending on the ASIL, there are different expectations in terms of what needs doing. Something specific to functional safety is that code coverage has to be measured in order to justify the fact that testing has been carried out intensively enough. The next phase concerns all further integration at test levels up to the completely integrated software. The topics are the same as those at the software unit level. Have safety mechanisms been implemented? Is there no unintended software? Are there enough resources? Here too, a methodical approach is necessary for test cases and testing. And the test coverage needs to be measured. I don't have to go into that here. Unlike with automotive spies, there is a separate clause for functional safety which refers to the fact that the developed embedded software must meet the software safety requirements placed on it, on the target hardware, in the target environment. It should be tested in different environments. First, the hardware should be tested with the software in a simulated environment. This is called hardware in the loop. Then it should be tested in a network of real electronic control units. And finally, it should be tested in prototype vehicles. Again, test cases must be specified using methods. Here are some typical examples of such methods. And finally, of course, the requirements must be tested. And faults should be deliberately introduced to test the safety mechanisms. Do the algorithms really recognize faults and trigger the desired reaction? So, we've been through the specific expectations of software development for automotive and functional safety. I would like to summarize the 9 key lessons that are worth highlighting and keeping. Number 1. With the increasing proportion of software in vehicles and with further steps towards automatic driving, the safety of vehicles depends more and more on error-free software. Second, faults in software must also be avoided through systematic development. Third, the possibility of faults occurring must be countered by mechanisms for fault tolerance. Number 4. Functional safety also requires the software development process to be adapted to the content and requirements of ISO 26262. Number 5. The technical safety requirements from the system level must be detailed down to high-quality safety requirements for software before they can be implemented. Lesson number 6. The software architecture must implement all functional requirements and safety mechanisms. It is often not possible to separate the two in vehicle electronics. 7th. Safety analysis must be performed to understand the dependencies between software components. The aim of this is to validate software design. Number 8. A number of methods have to be used for software integration and tests. And of course, the tests have to be carried out successfully before the final software version is released. And the 9th and last point, test coverage must be measured. This is in order to evaluate the completeness of testing and supports the rationale that test goals have been achieved. So, those were the key lessons. You now know the specific factors that need to be considered for functional safety in software development. However, this video only provided an overview, so many topics could go into much more detail. Nonetheless, this was a long video. Well done if you made it this far. If you want to study all of this slowly again, I can thoroughly recommend our white paper on this video. Or you can watch other videos from our playlists on functional safety. In this respect, we'll see you in the next video. And don't forget to recommend our videos if you like them. See you.